Hello, I'm Professor Yang Seung-min. Gingiva around an implant or natural tooth can be divided into keratinized gingiva and mucosa. There are many different opinions regarding the roles of keratinized gingiva. Tooth deficiency decreases the comfort of a patient and stable implant maintenance cannot be possible. It is recommended the keratinized gingiva should be sufficiently regenerated before implant procedure. Let's look at keratinized gingiva that is necessary for implant procedure. Contents, the need for keratinized gingiva, roles of keratinized gingiva in terms of oral hygiene, soft tissue health, gingival resession, alveolar bone loss, and peri-implant health. And we'll look at the meaning of vestibular depth and summary. First, the need for keratinized gingiva. If you look at clinical photos of two patients, both of them wear overdentures. The left patient has sufficient keratinized gingiva around the abutments, and the right patient does not have the gingiva. How would they feel about it, and what does that affect implants? Here, the patient doesn't have sufficient keratinized gingiva. What does the patient feel about it? The implants were removed due to peri-implantitis. Is it related to the deficient keratinized gingiva? If the patient cannot have good oral hygiene, apart from the controversy regarding the role of a keratinized gingiva, it is important to have that for oral hygiene. There are many reasons for deficient keratinized gingiva. A movable gingiva margin would facilitate the introduction of microorganisms into the gingival crevice, because muscular and the frenum pull occurs. So keratinized tissue minimizes the muscular and frenum pull, and it provides a circumferential sealing effect. Do we need keratinized gingiva or not? Some say absolutely necessary, and some say, why do we need that? What is important is we need to maintain soft tissue health and stability around an implant. Do we need the gingiva or not? There has been two contradictory views on that. When it comes to an implant, presence or absence of keratinized gingiva doesn't matter, according to one group of opinions. And there was another report that said a severe gingival resession occurs due to the plaque-induced inflammation when the peri-implant keratinized gingiva is deficient. And the controversy still continues. I'm going to introduce the controversy and I will leave the decision to you individually. The importance of keratinized gingiva, as I said before, let's have a look at it from five different perspectives. First, in terms of oral hygiene and the importance of keratinized gingiva, plaque accumulation. Plaque index is the variable. The presence of keratinized gingiva. And there are people who believe that has positive relationship with oral hygiene. And there's another group of people who believe there's a no relationship. There was no one who says there's a negative relationship. So the plaque accumulation improves with the presence of keratinized gingiva. And there is another group which said there is no relationship between those two. So there are many different papers on that. For doctors as well as patients, if you see this type of patient, the oral hygiene is very poor. You can see calculus. If implants are there instead of natural teeth, when oral hygiene is poor like that, if there is absence of keratinized gingiva, what will happen? Also, it will depend on the degree of oral hygiene, but still, in conclusion, no patient reported pain or discomfort in oral hygiene procedures in a keratinized tissue group, while almost 40% of the patients in the group without keratinized tissue reported discomfort in performing oral hygiene. That means if a patient has discomfort, he or she is reluctant to do brushing. They try to avoid it. At the beginning, they will just avoid brushing. But what does that mean in the long run? Not very good results. If opportunity comes, we will deal with this. From the cyst perspective, we look at the management around an implant. Cyst perspective means depending on the degree of inflammation around implant and the radiological bone loss, the approach would be different. C and D at the bottom means in a group with less keratinized tissue, there has been more surgical approaches used. In terms of percentage, much higher percentage there. That means the situation is much worse. What are the reasons for that? As I said before, the patient complained discomfort during oral hygiene procedure. There's a difference between the keratinized tissue group and non-keratinized tissue group. The presence of keratinized mucosa is not absolutely necessary, but it can be beneficial during oral hygiene performance, like teeth brushing. In connection to that, this is looking at soft tissue health in terms of importance of keratinized gingiva, bleeding index, gingiva index, and bleeding on probing, and the degree of inflammation are used as variables or indicators. There's a positive relationship and no relationship. Those two opposing groups exist. What does that signify? The amount of keratinized mucosa has little influence on soft tissue inflammation in the presence of good oral hygiene. And good oral hygiene group showed a lot of keratinized mucosa. This conclusion is in line with the previous conclusion. Let's look at gingival resession. One group says keratinized gingiva would prevent gingival recession. So here it looks like there is positive relationship. Keratinized gingiva presence prevents gingival recession according to investigators. If you look at here, abutment collars are exposed on the implants that have been used for a long time. That means, as I said before, the presence of keratinized tissue is associated with less soft tissue recession. In the photo, you can see frenum, some muscles or frenum due to their pulling force, they become movable, increasing gingival recession. Regarding alveolar bone loss, there can be controversy, but still, more investigators are supporting positive relationship between keratinized gingiva and alveolar bone loss. This is similar to the previous case of gingival recession. However, it is very difficult, hard to reach a conclusion looking at just one side. Therefore, it requires further investigation. Keratinized gingiva affects many different elements. First, oral hygiene, tissue inflammation, gingival recession, and loss of alveolar bone. However, which one is affected more by keratinized gingiva? There is no consensus reached, but from a clinical perspective, the width of keratinized gingiva, that is from free gingival margin to mucogingival junction, if it is more than 2 millimeters in terms of a plaque control, it helps. So, it can affect personal oral hygiene. Some patients do not brush quite often, but for those who do brushing quite well, when the environment is good, very good outcome can be achieved. There are controversy over keratinized gingiva, but in terms of personal oral hygiene, keratinized gingiva is necessary. Similarly, for peri-implant health, does keratinized mucosa help? Many investigators have different opinions. However, according to a consensus regarding peri-implantitis reported in 2018, keratinized mucosa may have advantages regarding patient comfort and ease of plaque removal for oral hygiene. So that is the conclusion. Four variables we saw before, gingival recession and alveolar bone loss, can be set aside, but regarding oral hygiene and inflammation, keratinized mucosa may have advantages. If you look at the clinical case of a patient, the most posterior area, number 7, where implant is placed, there is hardly any keratinized tissue, number 6 as well, and the keratinized tissue is grafted. And patient can do better oral hygiene on that side, so no more inflammation or bone loss occurred. So this is closely related to personal oral hygiene. If personal oral hygiene improves, stable long-term maintenance can be made. So around implants, clinical significance of keratinized gingiva, as I said before, it can give resistance to mechanical trauma. Simply put, brushing. So there is less mobile tissues and more smooth cleaning can be done with less mobility. It can prevent excessive movement of marginal gingiva. The ceiling remains, it's not broken. It prevents ingress of food into the gingiva sulcus. Regarding bone loss, I need to be very careful, but we think it can give a benefit in terms of bone loss. With the keratinized gingiva, it keeps the depth of oral vestibule. It opens the way for brushing, which is very important. So if you look at these two, on one side, there is gingival recession and abutments are exposed. And on the other side, that is not the case, but good oral hygiene has been achieved and no bone loss because the deep vestibule has been achieved and the brushes can go in there, improving personal oral hygiene. Despite gingival recession, we can see oral hygiene is pretty good. Meaning of vestibular depth, as I said before, it opens the way for brushing, so it reduces trauma to cervical gingiva caused by food. It decreases accumulation of plaque at cervical area due to self-cleansing effect of saliva. So, self-cleansing effect of saliva plays a role in an oral cavity. The depth of vestibule, it is necessary to increase the depth of vestibule in patients who complain of discomfort when brushing and chewing. There are many ways, but by securing keratinized tissue, the benefit can be achieved. Soft tissue augmentation procedure is necessary when keratinized tissue is deficient. Summary. The roles of keratinized gingiva is controversial. To maintain health of soft tissue around an implant that helps, keratinized gingiva is not necessary but sufficient for supporting oral hygiene, and we need to be aware of these, and you need to check the amount of keratinized tissue around implants. Over time after extraction, bone loss occurs. The width and the thickness of gingiva can decrease. So if you plan to place an implant in such areas, you can regenerate keratinized tissue before placing an implant or after placing an implant. Keratinized tissue can be grafted. So I hope this has reminded you of the importance of keratinized tissue. Thank you for your listening.